We will start the Q&A session, and there are a couple of questions from the audience. So, well, one of the first questions that has been asked is whether pre-transplant MRD positivity in high-risk AML is a sufficient reason to postpone allotransplant. Is the aim to induce MRD negativity? And maybe Adriana, you can allude a little bit on this question. You recently wrote a kind of position paper in Leukemia on this topic.
We wrote the position paper. Well, this is a burning issue, of course, and that is one of the points which I alluded to during my presentation. My opinion is that MRD positivity, pre-transplant MRD positivity should not be a contraindication for the delivery of an allogeneic stem cell transplant. And, of course, as Charles mentioned before, this is a matter for clinical trials. We have a lot of work to do, but being MRD positive should not be a contraindication. I mean, the data that I presented and also the data that Charles presented clearly showed that MRD positive patients can benefit from an allogeneic stem cell transplant procedure. And this is a category that can benefit the most from such an approach, especially exploiting the potential of graft versus leukemia. Finally, I would point out that nowadays we have available different additional approaches to make the transplant procedure even more effective. I mentioned before the role of maintenance. FLT3 inhibitors are currently being used after allogeneic stem cell transplant. And I can guess that in the next future, there will be a role also for oral azacitidine based on the impressive results that were presented at the AIA meeting. Thank you.
Adriana, Charlie, would you like to comment on this? Or
I echo what Adriana has said. I think this is a really important point. Firstly, it's of pivotal importance that we have prospective evaluations of the impact of MRD, both pre- and post-transplant. It's simply not acceptable to be basing our treatment choices on retrospective analysis, which, as we know, are all subject to considerable selection bias. And our large randomized study looking at pre-transplant flow MRD, as Adriano says, it shows many people with MRD positivity can go on to achieve long-term survival. And I think also our data points to the fact that we have to think about transplant in a much more sophisticated way. It's not just a single modality. You can use a RIC or a MAC regimen. I think Chris Hurrigan's data might say in patients with MRD positivity, if it is possible to use a MAC regimen, you should. But in patients in whom you can only safely deliver a RIC, and that's many patients, then the focus should be on augmenting a graft versus tumor effect, tapering cyclosporin earlier, using possibly lower cyclosporin, intervening with DLI. And these are all fertile areas for examination in randomized trials. But finally, again, to agree with Adriana, there is no randomized data to show that even in patients who are MRD positive, converting to MRD negative is going to improve transplant outcome. We are now recruiting in the UK to a separate study, COSI, where we are asking that question. And we're randomizing patients who are allomandatory, who are destined to come into transplant for their final course of chemo before they come in for transplant is going to be CPX versus intermediate dose ARA-C. And I think such randomized studies using potentially other more innovative agents such as venetoclax are going to be really important in examining whether switching people to a lower MRD state or MRD negativity is of any clinical benefit. It may not be. And in the meanwhile, knowing that a significant number of such patients can achieve long-term remission after an allograft, they should proceed to transplant.
Thank you, Charlie. I completely agree with you that we need some randomized study to show that MRD conversion from MRD positivity to MRD negativity pre-transplant is really of value. I don't think these studies are available yet. And they are very difficult to perform, but these are really urgently needed. I have another question for Christian. Christian, many study groups use double U21 as a marker for MRD assessment, and it's never mentioned in the ELN recommendation. Can you allude a little bit on that?
Well, this is an ongoing matter of discussion. Of course, many people are very happy with WT1. And of course, if there is no other MRD marker which is better than WT1, then this marker should be used. So applying a less applicable marker to detect MRD is better than doing no MRD detection at all. But the matter of discussion with WT1 is actually that, and that has been shown by late David Grimwaite in very elegant studies and other people as well, that you have a certain level of background positivity which makes this marker less sensitive than, for example, a standard qPCR marker like the translocation, CBF translocations, or NPM1. So, because people, when they think of molecular MRD, they usually tend to throw everything in one bin, and one has to discriminate and actually have in mind that WT1, the sensitivity of WT1, is probably at the same level as flow cytometry, and therefore, of course, flow cytometry has also been used. But I think we have to become better and have to have better markers like the translocations like NPM1 and hopefully next generation sequencing in the future. So it's not that we are discouraging of completely using WT1, but it should be used in an appropriate way and should only be used in those patients where there is no other sensitively detectable marker available.
Thank you, Christian. Clear. So, question for Jacqueline. Jacqueline, can you allude a little bit on the value of the leukemic stem cell as a marker for MRD?
Yes. So, we have shown retrospectively that having these leukemia stem cells in MRD samples really shows a subgroup of patients that have a very poor survival. And in addition, even at diagnosis, having a high frequency of these leukemia stem cells is highly predictive of a high risk of relapse. The only thing that is a disadvantage of at this moment looking at stem cells is that we can only do it for patients who are CD34 positive, because the stem cells that we can identify are CD34 positive and CD38 negative with a specific leukemia marker. Fortunately, this is of course the majority of patients, but we don't have a leukemia stem cell marker for the CD34 negative patients. But we think, and hopefully in the next Hovon trial that we are about to reveal, we hope to see that we have also shown prospectively that these leukemia stem cells are highly relevant.
Thanks, Jacqueline. And a question for you, Charlie. It's a question from someone we know very well. And he asks, and I do not know whether you are aware of this study from the Yuan group from Beijing, showing an overall advantage for sorafenib maintenance after LO. So the question is, are you aware of this study and how do you assess this study? Because I don't think it's published yet.
It just came out online, actually, Kurt, and it's an important study looking at sorafenib maintenance, showing a reduction in cumulative incidence of relapse in the experimental arm. And there's a very nice accompanying editorial by Mohamed Moti. So I do think there's some building data supporting benefit of sorafenib as a maintenance strategy through randomized studies, pivotally important through two randomized studies now supporting this approach. I guess the question is how well it's tolerated. In that Chinese study, it seemed to be reasonably well tolerated, but also which patients benefit. And one of the important aspects, I think, of the Mark Levis Morpho study, CTN-1506, that closed out about 6 months ago, is they've got very meticulous pre- and post-transplant MRD documentation. And so it may be, if that study is positive, that we will also be able to identify which patients should receive these potentially toxic therapies. You know, those of us who work in this area of maintenance will attest to the fact that actually many patients post-transplant find compliance with long-term administration of such agents quite challenging. And so I do think, as well as the importance of the Chinese study showing a benefit, it will be important going forward trying to understand who benefits.
Thank you, Charlie. So there are quite a number of questions on maintenance treatment, and I would ask pass this question to Adriano. Adriano, one of the questions is how should we use MRD in the maintenance setting, and for how long should we give maintenance, and how often should we measure MRD? So I know these are very difficult questions, so maybe you can answer, and maybe Charlie or Christian can add to that.
These questions are really difficult to answer, and of course it's a matter of clinical trials. In our experience, we measure MRD after allogeneic stem cell transplant every 3 months. That means four testings per year. But of course, I'm not sure that is the correct approach. And once again, we need more robust indication generated within dedicated clinical trials, keeping in mind that some situation of MRD positivity can have a quite prompt and sudden acceleration into an overt disease. I think that we all agree on this behavior in a situation of NPM1 positivity. So I think we need clinical trial.
Christian, could you add to that?
Sure. So I think, as Adriano mentioned, there are no clear data, but of course we have some evidence. First evidence is the majority of relapses after transplantation occurs in the first 1 to 2 years. So this is actually the time where you are most obliged to detect MRD or to measure MRD. And of course, one has also to discriminate according to the materials used. So according to the ELN recommendations, bone marrow should be used probably every 3 months. If you have only peripheral blood available, you should do it more frequently, probably in the range of 4 to 6 weeks, because you lose about one log of sensitivity when you're measuring MRD in this material. I think a good idea, at least in high-risk patients, might be to combine these two efforts, combining bone marrow and peripheral blood, and doing bone marrow every 3 months or every 2 months, even if the patient tolerates this, and putting peripheral blood in between, not to miss these rapidly occurring relapses in some patients.
Thank you. So data is lacking currently, and we need really randomized study. And one of the randomized study that is really important is the one that is done by Charlie Craddock, investigating whether maintenance with CC4X6 post-transplant is of importance. So I have one last question to maybe to all of you. Can you say in one sentence what will be the pivotal trial for surrogacy to show that MRD is a surrogate for overall survival? So start with you, Adriano.
Well, the perfect trial, in my view, is the one that uses MRD targeting agents, showing that MRD positive situations can be reverted to MRD negativity. And I think that we have nowadays plenty of new agents that can potentially and theoretically serve this this mission. We mentioned the FLT3 inhibitors. We mentioned the oral azacitidine. But I think that also attempts are ongoing with agents such as venetoclax, for instance.
Thank you. So I think in the sake of time, we have to conclude because we are nearly approaching 10 o'clock and that's the end of this symposium. So I would like to summarize and conclude a little bit on this interesting discussion and really want to end the session with repeating the questions that we started at the beginning of this symposium. So establishing MRD as a surrogate endpoint, where are we now? Well, Jacqueline showed you nicely that there are a couple of methods in which we try to show which cells are important for the relapse in acute myeloid leukemia. We can measure those residual cells with either flow or with molecular methods. And Christian Tiede showed us nicely that NGS is one of the emerging methods. So when you found MRD, what do you have to do with it? Well, first of all, you can assess the response. So CR MRD negativity is a new response criteria in the AML criteria proposed by the group of Hartmut Dörner. It can refine outcome predictions and risk stratify, inform treatment decisions. We had a lot of discussion already on that, and it gives you the possibility to identify potential for relapse and enable early intervention. And last but not least, it could serve as a surrogate endpoint. That is not proven yet, but hopefully this will be proven in the upcoming years, because this will really be important for a faster drug improvement. And the ELN MRD working party have recently published already a recommendation, and this is really work in progress because this group is continuing doing research, and Jacqueline and Christian showed already a little bit of that. There will be an update of this recommendation in 2021, and we had already given recommendations, and the work in progress is given on the lower part of this slide. So again, it will design new panels for MRD testing. It will explore the value of leukemic stem cells. More sophisticated analysis programs are really tested currently by this group. It would be an enormous advantage when we can use peripheral blood instead of bone marrow. Certainly when we talk about maintenance situation, when we have to perform repeated MRD assessment, it would be an enormous advantage to do that from the peripheral blood instead of from the bone marrow. And, well, of course, the NGS is emerging, as Christian showed us, but a lot of work has to be done for harmonization and standardization, and that's work in progress. Hopefully, the new recommendation will be published in 2021. They will not be giving answers on all these burning questions. And then, I think we did not discuss this in this symposium in depth, but maybe combining different MRD techniques could be of value. And Wiehoven already showed that when you are positive in three different MRD assessments, then you can predict a relapse in really every patient. And that's possible due to the fact that multiple methods detect partly different populations of leukemia initiating cells, and a combination of methods could be a solution for decreasing false positive negativity. And then my last slide, Harmony is a public-private partnership. It's a big data project funded by EU with a, really a lot of partners, industry, patients, major AML groups are participating in that. And the aim of this Harmony project is to harmonize outcome measures and endpoint definitions for all kinds of hematological malignancies at the European level, but also for AML. And we have started now a new project in acute myeloid leukemia to see whether we could prove that MRD is really a surrogate marker for survival in AML. We will do this with the data from all the major European AML groups on an individual patient level correlation. So hopefully this will be the first attempt to show the predictive value of acute myeloid leukemia. And with this, I think I can conclude. MRD is an emerging tool in the treatment of acute myeloid leukemia. Detection of MRD by whatever technology after treatment is really a bad sign. All clinical studies should incorporate MRD assessment. And I should also say, out of clinical trials, you should apply MRD. Standardization and harmonization is work in progress, as I already showed you, that has been done by the ELN MRD working party currently, and the acceptance of MRD as a surrogate for survival would be an enormous benefit, especially for the faster drug approval. With that, I would like to end the session. I would like to thank all the speakers for really the excellent presentations, and I would like to thank all the participants who were really a lot present for early Sunday morning. I would like them for the active participation, asking questions. So with that, I would like to end this first AML Hub Satellite Symposium. Thank you so much.